Kejriwal, thank you for sparing the time to come and talk at the summit. It's been an extremely busy time for you. We want to talk on the larger issue, on the ideas behind the movement and how it's actually moved forward after those key days, those 12 days, which we saw changed in many ways the Indian polity and their response to a civil movement. When you look at it today, the old adage that with great power comes great responsibility, do you feel the movement is being responsible at the current moment going ahead?
First, I just want to react. I'm not a former RTI activist. I'm still an RTI activist. I think one thing is the movement has generated so much of positive energy everywhere. There are so many stories that we keep on hearing from across the country. For instance, when we were at Ramlila Maidan, a policeman came to me and said, "Ki saab, pichle 16 saal se main rishwat leta raha, lekin pichle 10 din se maine ek bhi paisa nahi liya." और इन 10 दिनों में जितना आनंद मैंने महसूस किया उतना 16 साल में मैंने महसूस नहीं किया. Immediately after Anna's fast, I went to Pune. I went to a bakery shop, and that bakery wala told me that every month, in the first week of that month, about inspectors from around 15 departments used to come to my shop and ask for bribe. He said, "Today it is 10th day of this month, but till now not a single inspector has come." You also must have seen so many stories which were there by the name of Anna effect immediately after Anna's fast got over in the TV channels, in which one auto driver, auto rickshaw driver in Madhya Pradesh, he got a bag of jewelry 5 years back and he kept that jewelry bag. And now after Anna's fast, he returned that jewelry bag to the police. So there are so many stories which are coming from across the country where people are, they've stopped giving bribes, they've stopped taking bribes, or they are at least protesting against bribery. The challenge is how do we strengthen all these or this entire positive energy. I completely agree with Sonia. This whole movement has put a huge amount of responsibility on the leadership of the movement, and it's quite scary at times. There are too many hopes and there are too many aspirations that the people have. And I also concede that many people who came on the streets, they did not come on the streets for just Lokpal bill. They did not come on the streets only for Jan Lokpal bill. They feel they have a dream ki ab to Bharat badlega, ab to sab theek ho jayega. Wo hoga ki nahi hoga, ye to samay batayega.
Yeah, Arvind, is this mic on? Arvind, right from the beginning, you know, I think there's been unstinting sense of commending and of praise and of hope from the campaign that, you know, you all have put together. There is certainly, like you're saying, there's moments of personal transformation. There is, you've given voice to a frustration that has lain embedded for a long time. And also that one never thought it would become the burning issue of our time. You know, corruption was something that was acceptable. It was the second economy in the country. All of that is wonderful, Arvind. But I think the anxiety around the Lokpal debate has been that there is something about emotion, you know, the junoon that you have aroused in people, what you're talking about, you know, individual people wanting to give up corruption. And then there is the very complex process of legislating. For a country as diverse as India, complex, in that, do you feel now 8-9 months into the campaign that some of these goalposts need to be changed, need to be rethought, you know, that maybe we need to do some of this differently?
You see, there's always scope for introspection, and we all keep on meeting and we keep on discussing how, what was right and what was wrong. There are a lot of brainstorming sessions. So there's certainly a scope for, always a scope for improvement. If you can specifically say that these are the things which were wrong or which were right, then one could point to that.
Well, for instance, I think right from the beginning, there has been, you know, the initial Jan Lokpal bill draft that was put out, and which for a long time there was a pressure that that is the version that should go through. there was a desire to put the judiciary, the higher bureaucracy, the lower bureaucracy, the prime minister, all the members of parliament, everyone under the same institution. And that has created anxiety in a lot of people, you know. Today, seeing the kind of, you know, fractures that can develop even within the group itself, differing pressures, would you feel today, apart from what the parliament decides, out of your own thinking and introspection, that with the same goals in mind, the same principles of transparency, accountability, that maybe it's better to break these institutions up rather than centralize power in one institution?
This I don't agree. You see, first, a very wrong impression is being created that we are adamant and we are not willing to have a dialogue. The first version of Jal Lokpal Bill was created on 1st December 2010. After that, there have been series of public consultations. There have been series of seminars across the country. We have gone to villages. We have done several consultations across the country. We set up a website. We invited comments from the people. We received more than 3,000 comments from the public. And on the basis of that, there have been 14 versions of Jan Lokpal Bill. Every time, every week, we used to come out with a new version on the basis of feedback that we were receiving. That is the process that Jan Lokpal Bill has gone through, which is never being highlighted. But what has the government done? The government's Lokpal Bill was created by 5 ministers sitting in a room with no public consultations, thrust upon the people of this country. And the Lokpal Bill that was presented in the parliament in August, what did that Lokpal Bill say? That Lokpal Bill said that if you make a complaint of corruption to Lokpal, and if there is insufficient evidence of corruption, then you can be put behind bars for 2 years. But if you prove corruption, then 6 months of jail to the corrupt officer. So 2 years of jail to the citizen and 6 months of jail to the corrupt officer. This is the kind of law that the government has brought. And when we criticize this law, and when we say that this is not acceptable to us, it is alleged we are accused of being adamant and intolerant. You see, I think we need to appreciate the process that this Jan Lokpal Bill has gone through. It has gone through huge amount of consultations, and if you see the first version and the last version, in fact, Uttarakhand recently has, 2 days back, has passed a very good Lokayukt Act. Here also, there were 3 or 4 rounds of discussions with their officers. We sat with them. They told us that what are the different problems that are there in the state and how it needs. So we agreed to all those amendments. But one thing we need to understand is that discussions and dialogue are extremely important in democracy, which the government does not seem to be interested in engaging.
Let me just bring in Shekhar at this point. Shekhar, both Arvind and you have had the experience of the Right to Information Bill, and that point had been made that the Right to Information Bill faced a similar problem. The initial version that came was weak. It wasn't accepted by RTI activists, but it went through the process of parliamentary standing committees. It went through the process of not being accepted, and the bill that finally came out through the parliamentary standing committee and after protest by activists like Arvind, yourself, Aruna Roy, was a bill that was much more acceptable. Many expressed dismay that why that process wasn't followed for this as well. What are your views on it? And do you accept what Arvind's point is, that if this hadn't happened, we wouldn't have seen a new version of the Lokpal Bill? It would have, like its language for the last 40 years, it would have been a similar fate with this.
Well, let me start by saying that what we have seen since April in the terms of the India Against Corruption and the Anna movement is a remarkable movement. We might have differences with it, I have, but it is an outstanding movement. And I also would like to put on record, because this is a recurring theme in the media, that as far as the leaders of that movement, at least the two that I know well, Arvind and Prashant, their credentials and their credibility, as far as I'm concerned, are unquestionable. And I'd rather say that I'm corrupt than they're corrupt. Let's put this way. But it's also rare to be able to say this in sincerity about somebody whom you actually disagree with quite a bit. And I do disagree with that, and then he knows this. First of all, let me tell you where the NCPRI and many of us have disagreed. And when I say NCPI, I feel bad because Arvind is also a member of the working committee, the NCPRI, so we are together. But anyway, where the two of us disagree. See, they feel that the focus is, the main problem is corruption. We feel no. The main problem is concentration of too much power in any one institution. Corruption is a symptom of that, as is, for example, oppression and injustice. So what we have to do is disempower the government. what we have to do is not just disempower the government, but not take away that power and give it to the corporate sector, or give it to the media, or give it to any other institution, but to distribute it among people. And that is what the RTI Act has done. That is why you've got 1.2 billion Lokpals coming up, each using an RTI. Now, where we disagree with him is this, that if you're going to set up a Lokpal, which is so powerful, that that itself will sort of, in some senses, vie with the government for power. I can think if that Lokpal, Jan Lokpal comes in, people would rather be Lokpals than be prime ministers. In fact, you, Arvind, would agree with me that when corruption took a new turn in civil services, we found a phenomena where people who joined civil servants would rather join the income tax department than the IAS, because more money was to be made here, you see. So we don't want that sort of a problem. So we are saying, let us not replace one concentration of power with another concentration of power. Let us build a multitude of institutions, each of which can check and balance the other. And the second point I want to make where we disagree. You see, the term independence is very attractive. We all want to. It's a middle-class fantasy that let's not waste time. Let's set up an independent institution with a large enough stick to keep everybody in position. But don't forget, independence means lack of accountability. The more independent an organization, the less accountable it is. Do we really want to set up a monster of the sort where tomorrow, barring hardcore corruption, if they all decide to play golf the whole day and do nothing, we can't question it. And this is what's happening, for example, with the information commissioner, because they're independent. Once they get appointed, and you'll agree with me, in fact, Arvind has done this study, they don't do any work, they don't impose any penalties, but there's nothing we can do about it. So our difference of opinion has been this. Now, the last point I would want to make, Arvind today says, and I believe him, that they are open to discussion. Where the problem started was that when in the beginning of April, when their hunger strike started, a lot of their leaders made the following statements on international and national TV, saying the Jan Lokpal bill is perfect, and anybody who wants to change a word is either corrupt or supporting the corrupt. Now that was something which put us all off. Where is the debate then? I don't want to be held up as being corrupt. But now, I must say, before Arvind needs to say it, I must say that certainly it seems that what he says today, and he said before, the atmosphere has changed, and that we are now in a position to discuss and debate these things. I just like to end by saying that where we are totally together is that the government's Lokpal bill is junk, and that we have to come up with a master plan.
First is that we have been insisting on Jan Lokpal bill, and that is the reason, because that was placed against the government's Lokpal bill. And we've been saying that the Jan Lokpal bill should be passed. If we want to have discussion, let's have a discussion on public platform. We have invited everywhere, we invited people, we invited Shekhar, we invited Aruna, we invited government, we invited all versions. Let's have a discussion on public platform. There was no one took up this offer. So after April also, there have been four versions of Lokpal bill, Jan Lokpal bill, which clearly show that the entire group and the movement has been open to ideas. Number two, I think it is a wrong impression being created that this Jan Lokpal bill is going to be some kind of a super body. I'm sure that you need to give power to this body. If you want to tackle Raja's corruption, if you want to tackle Kalmadi's corruption, do you want Lokpal to go to Raja and with folded hands say that, Mr. Raja, please declare your corrupt money? You need to give them power to be able to raid Raja. You need to give them power to be able to confiscate his records. You need to give them power to be able to summon Raja. Only then you will be able to collect evidence. Only then will this body be empowered. Now let me tell you, what powers does this body have? Lokpal only and only has the power to investigate, just like CBI. CBI has the power to investigate, take the evidence to the court, and the court does the trial. So Lokpal would have, we are confusing, I think, between jurisdiction and powers. The jurisdiction of Lokpal, what we are saying is, Lokpal would have jurisdiction over the Prime Minister, the judiciary, the lower officers, and the upper officers. Doesn't the Income Tax Department have the same jurisdiction today? Income Tax Department also has jurisdiction over the Prime Minister, over the judiciary, over the Chief Justice, over the ministers, over the lower bureaucracy, over the upper bureaucracy. an income tax officer today, ordinary income tax group B officer, he has the power to scrutinize the income tax return of the Prime Minister of India and impose a penalty on him and impose taxes on him. No, just one second. But Lokpal's investigating officer, he will not have powers to impose any penalty. He can only, if there is any allegation of corruption against the Prime Minister, he can only and only investigate that and then take the matter to the court. And we are saying it's a super body. It's not a super body. Who is Lokpal accountable to? I would like to ask a counter question. If today the Chief Election Commissioner of India turns corrupt, can any one of you sitting in the audience, and I can see that there are many powerful people sitting here, can any one of you do anything to him? No, you can't. If the Controller and Auditor General of India turns corrupt, can you do anything about it? No, you can't. But if the Jan Lokpal turns corrupt, you have been given the power, an ordinary citizen has been given the power to make a complaint to the Supreme Court of India, which will be investigated in 3 months, and the Lokpal will be thrown out of his position.
You can see the mood in an audience like this. Every time that this discussion comes up about disagreements over the shape of the Lokpal, it's true, you do invite debate on public platforms. You held the referendum in Karol Bagh and all of that. The problem with that is, Arvind, that, you know, I think, you're saying that we are mistaking things. You're mistaking the mood of the people, which absolutely is anti-corruption, which is fed up, which wants strong accountability processes. But to have a discussion about the shape of the legislation in a public platform, I think it makes it difficult, you know, because then what we are doing is playing to the simplest desire in people, which is stop corruption. I don't think anybody in the world will say, no, we want corruption, you know. But the form of that has to be a discussion that is done with wise people, quietly, in closed-door conversations, and then put out for further feedback. Because what will happen, Arvind, is that if we begin to discuss the shape of this in front of even an audience like this, or in an even larger audience of ordinary people fed up with the things that happen to them on a daily basis, they're definitely going to want the magic wand. They're not going to think about future generations of checks and balances or any of that. So why is the plea only to have it on a public platform? Why not in considered discussions and then put out for public criticism?
Shoma, just one point on that. The allegation of the media oxygen that Anna Hazare and the team got, the playing to the gallery, the worry of that, the fear we see media virtually becoming part of the cause, and the same media turning on you and attacking certain members, and then team Anna saying, hey, why are you asking us these questions? Is there a dichotomy? Is there double standards there? And how did this whole playing to the gallery point, which Shoma raised as well?
So two questions.
You see what a public platform can become.
Yeah. We're all on the same side.
You see, Arvind has often said, I've heard you on the media saying, what is this great power we are talking about? After all, the income tax officer also has so much power. I think Arvind, God bless his soul, must be the only person in India who doesn't realize that the income tax department is very corrupt. So that power is being misused every day. And many of us, I certainly have been harassed by the income tax department. Now, we don't want to create another monster. Just because we have one does not define. And secondly, the sort of power that the Jan Lokpal would have, in fact, I don't know whether it's right, but media reports say that Anas ji has now said that we also want power to be able to sack officials in the Lokpal. So you have the power to investigate an official, you have the power to prosecute an official, and you have a power to sack an official. Good God, I mean, you know, this is amazing. If please make me the Lokpal if that bill comes in. I will have a great time, you know. You can run the country by yourself. So I really think you need to rethink this.
Quick question.
Now, as far as the power of an income tax officer is concerned, no one can say that there is no corruption in income tax department. But does that mean that you take away the powers of income tax officers and make them completely ineffective? Or does it mean that you make income tax officers accountable and punish them if they turn corrupt? If you take away the power of an income tax officer and make him completely ineffective, you might as well shut down income tax department. What is important is that there is absolutely, I was in income tax department, I've seen the entire department from inside. there is absolutely no accountability. You can just do whatever you want to. So what is important is to fix accountability, punish them if they do something wrong. But you have to give them the tools which are required to perform your job. You can't say that we will not give you power because power is being misused. You have to give them the power of raid. You have to give them the power of search, seizure, summons, confiscation. All these powers have to be there, which are basic powers to for any enforcement and investigative agencies. Otherwise, you might not have those powers.
Arvind, may I just intervene here? I think you're perfectly right about that. That's a
I've not answered your question.
I know, we asked you too many. I'm going to come back because we'll lose this thread. You know, you make this comparison between the income tax, and I think that's a perfect example of, say, the CBI, that you have been wanting that it should not seek permission of those that they have to investigate, and that is the first principle that must be executed. They must have powers, and they must have accountability. You know, the same transparency that you're trying to put into the Lokpal, we must put into the CBI. I don't think there's any argument over that. But the income tax department is only looking at our income tax violations. They are not going across the board from every kind of corruption that can exist because they don't have the expertise to do that. With the Lokpal, we want to invest a spectrum of powers over a spectrum of people in one institution.
No, you're
that
incorrect.
Is the anxiety.
The definition of corruption is not as wide as is popularly perceived to be. The definition of corruption is defined in Prevention of Corruption Act. We have a PC Act which was enacted in 1988 by Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. It defines what is corruption. It defines what is the punishment. But unfortunately, we do not have any independent agency to enforce that act. All that we are creating is an enforcement agency to enforce that act, nothing else. We are not doing anything else. Today, only CBI has the power to enforce that act. CBI is in the clutches of the government. All that we are saying is that make CBI independent and rename it at Lokpal. That's all we are doing, nothing else.
The aspect we talk about playing to the gallery, the media being an integral part of the whole Anna movement and how it became part of the process or in a way. Questions have now been raised about the accountability issue in terms of the political process. Is the Anna Hazare team a political player? You have said we are apolitical, but we are part of the political process. But again, does it evade the real questions that what happened in Hisar raised serious issues about where the movement is going forward? Was it immature? Why did you all decide Hisar? Anna Hazare then said we won't campaign against a party. Again, we've seen something yesterday said we will campaign against a particular party. Is there immaturity now in the way forward?
I just want to ask the audience that suppose in your area, if you have a bad road and you go to the local mayor and you ask them to repair the road, and if they don't repair the road and you come back in your locality and you tell everyone that, look, these people are not working. Next time, let's not vote for them. Is it illegitimate? It is not. So if, just one second. So if, this is exactly what we are doing at the national level. We've been asking the, just one second. Let me just complete my answer. We've been asking the government of India to enact a strong Lokpal bill for the last 1 year. The government has not been doing it. The government has been playing politics about it. So if we say that if the government does not enact a strong Lokpal bill, then don't vote for this government in the next elections, what's wrong with it?
No, just a minute. I think, Arvind, the problem there again is it's preemptive action. You know, for me, what's been problematic, and as Shekhar said, the beauty of this disagreement is that we are all on the same side of the table, you know.
Right.
So there is a particular beauty in us all disagreeing. I think the problem of this has been that, for a moment I've lost my...
can I take it?
I can take it. Just one second. I just wanted to add to that. You see, it is being accused that this movement, which was anti-corruption movement, has suddenly turned anti-Congress. We are not against Congress. We have nothing against Congress. We are just pleading before the ruling party, we are just pleading before the government that you pass a strong Lokpal bill. And that's it. That's all we want. It is their duty. Can Mayawati, if she wants, enact a Lokpal bill at the center? She can't. Can BJP, if they want, enact a strong Lokpal bill at the center? They can't. Can Mulayam Singh, if he wants, enact a strong Lokpal bill at the center? He can't. If Congress wants, they can enact a strong Lokpal bill at the center. If BJP, that is the reason we are saying that we have to put for, we have to pressurize Congress. If BJP had been in power at the center and they had not done this job, we would have told the people that if BJP does not support just strong Lokpal bill, don't vote for them in the next elections. What is wrong in saying that if the ruling party is not doing its job, don't vote for them? You see, the impression that is being given, the impression that is being given is, ये पॉलिटिक्स बड़ी गंदी चीज है, ये हमारे लिए छोड़ दो, आप समाज सेवा करो. हम सारे समाज सेवा करें और सारा गंदा काम वो लोग करते रहें. हम बोलेंगे कि अगर रूलिंग पार्टी काम नहीं करती है तो रूलिंग पार्टी को वोट नहीं देना चाहिए. इन माय ओपिनियन इट इज परफेक्टली अ लेजिटिमेट पार्ट ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी.
यू नो अरविंद, आई हैव जस्ट द वायरिंग इज बैक इन माय हेड. सो व्हाट आई वाज सेइंग इज दैट I think the problem with that was that it was preemptive action.
Yeah, know? There I can explain. There are some there is some misunderstanding in the general public. Why did we do it before winter session? This is your question. Why was it preemptive? There is a misunderstanding that when Annaji ended his fast, the government assured that it will be brought in winter session. There was no such agreement. There was no such assurance from the government side. We have the letter from the Prime Minister, which does not say that it will be brought in winter session. It just talks of three issues: Lokayukta, Citizens Charter, and Lower Bureaucracy, where the Prime Minister has said that today in Parliament the following resolution was passed and these three issues will be brought in the Lokpal bill. This is all it says. So Annaji said, for the rest of the issues we will keep on agitating, but I'm ending my fast. So this was a misconception. Now, when Hisar elections were supposed were taking place, many people from Hisar came and met us. And they said that we want to make Lokpal as an election issue in Hisar. How do you do that? If you ask all the candidates to sign on a piece of paper, they'll sign anywhere. But after the election, they will say, my party president is not agreeing to us. So it was said that you go and get a letter of assurance from your party president that this bill will come in winter session and they will support Lokpal bill in a strong Lokpal bill in winter session. Let all the party presidents sign this. Everyone else signed a letter except Congress. So on 3rd October, Annaji made a press statement saying that we are still waiting for three more days and we urge Congress to give at least some letter that this bill is coming in winter session and we will pass a strong Lokpal bill. Still the letter did not come. So after that, this campaign was done, and the biggest achievement of this campaign was on 10th we ended our campaign, and on 10th evening we got a letter from the Prime Minister saying that they will bring it in winter session.
Arvind, the Prime Minister said as he said earlier, and the Prime Minister said as he had already said earlier, so he didn't really say that didn't say there's an impact of the Hisar campaign at all in that sense. But Shekhar, I'd like you to come in here. On this whole engagement, this quasi-engagement, the political process, is that something that you're comfortable with? Do you see that as the way forward for movements like this?
See, there, interestingly, I am with Arvind. Mm-hmm. I feel that we must mobilize people. In fact, I am a great believer that we have to make democracy work. And you have to mobilize voters in specific issues to make them. Whether I agree with these specifics is a separate matter. But this brings in a larger question where our disagreement continues. Even when the movement, the first phase was going on, leaders of the India Against Corruption made the following statements on TV. Fortunately, TV now, you can't even deny that you were misquoted because it's there for everybody. They said that if the government wants to make, they must bring in the Jan Lokpal bill. Jan Lokpal, not Lokpal. If they want to make one or two changes, the government can consult Anna. And if he agrees, make the changes. Now, I feel that arrogance of that sort undermines democracy.
That I agree. That I completely concede. Some people from the stage had said that, and I think it's not correct.
Okay. So, and this is the spirit. For example, what Arvind has said today is wonderful. I just wish that there was a mechanism that you had that when these statements were made, somebody could get up and say, look, we are not a party to this.
Because no, but you said that, Shekhar.
But
I
it
tell you,
come out as so prominently. But I watch TV nonstop.
When, no.
Shekhar, aren't you out on the field working?
I take portable TVs.
When the movement was taking place and now was sitting on its fast, the entire emotional quotient and the pitch was very high. Many people came on the stage who were not our people. but this statement was made by one of our persons. Many statements were made. Whenever we got a chance, we have dissociated ourselves, the movement, from those. For instance, I will not name the person, but some person said Anna is India and India is Anna. That's not right. It was.
Person reiterated it later when she was asked.
Yeah, but that's right. But the movement does not support. Just one second. Does not support these kind of statements. Anna is not India, and India is not Anna. India is much, much bigger than Anna. For instance, I was accused of having said that Anna is superior to Parliament. I never said it.
That you didn't. Yeah.
I didn't. If you go to Karan Thapar, was mischievous in putting those as headlines. I said, if you go on the net and if you see that program, I said citizens of India are superior to Parliament, which I still believe that superior citizens of India are superior to Parliament. Then he asked, what about Anna? I said, Anna is also one of the citizens of India. The next day headline was, Arvind Kejriwal, Anna is superior to Parliament. Anna is not superior to Parliament.
Arvind, you know, I think it's a big part of the problem of this campaign, which is such a... It has been difficult because, as I said, it is this mood of deterrence that you've created is wonderful. But like you conceded right now, that some statements were, you know, were not true to the spirit of the movement or spirit. But when you keep saying the movement, and then they are very core people to the group who've been making statements like this, would you now, again in the cool of 8 months passing, that the problem has been the rhetoric? You know, it is not a loud discussion. I think you yourselves have fallen into this binary. Just a minute, Arvind. I agree you've had consultations. But I think you also are trapped in that binary that there's the Jan Lokpal and there's a government bill. The government bill was bad. The Jan Lokpal bill was faulty. Why has there been not a de-escalation of rhetoric so that one can begin to discuss a bill that we all will be comfortable with and which will be good, so that we are not trapped in this binary of bad government and good citizens' movement?
Where do we discuss this?
But I think that's the fun thing.
That brings me to the next interesting
which
point.
Which is the platform where it should be discussed?
I think the media, certainly. And I think in an earlier conversation...
So I would...
No, just...
No, let's accept that.
No, just a minute.
Let's accept that. Just one second.
No, Arvind, I haven't finished.
Tehelka Arvind, to
haven't
invite the representatives from the government and also from Arunaji and from Jaipur, all the camps which are there, and have a 3 or 4 hours of public discussion. We are willing to come for that.
Sure. But Arvind... Sonia, just a minute. Arvind, that is easily done, and my editor is saying to announce it will be done. You know. But Arvind, and I was cut short. What I meant was that the media is one place where public discourse can happen. What I was asking you is, when you said, where will this happen? There is a parliamentary process. I think what has also been problematic is that because 40 years we have not done something, we suddenly want to leapfrog. You know, those were other parliaments. It was not this parliament. We can't hold other parliaments, this parliament guilty of what other parliaments didn't do. So why are we trying to leapfrog the democratic process, not believe that the Parliament Standing Committee will do its job, and not be willing to let the thing take its time so that it comes out correct?
We never said that. The Parliament will take its time. The Parliament will do its job.
You've been calling it dilatory tactics, always.
Of course it is a dilatory tactic. And if you want to isolate this Parliament from the earlier Parliaments, I don't want to do that. The country has been waiting for the last 42 years. This bill was first introduced in Parliament in 1968. And since then, the country has been waiting for this law. There is a direct conflict of interest in this particular law, because the people who are supposed to legislate on this law, many of them would go to jail if they passed a strong Lokpal bill. So therefore, there is a very strong reason to believe for the people of this country that the people of this country ought to directly engage on this particular issue, if not many other issues. Why are you thinking that only if the people of this country want a strong Lokpal bill, they want to engage in this particular process, and you are saying that no, the people should not be involved, let's leave it entirely to Parliament? I don't believe in that.
I didn't say that. I said there are many prongs, there are many layers of it.
Let's use the parliamentary processes, but let's strengthen those parliamentary processes and create mechanisms to get people's feedback also. Let's not leave out the people of India from the Parliament of India.
People of India are voting in these very politicians that you talk about. Is the worry this is all in broad strokes? Politicians haven't come from outer space, they've been voted in. No, I'm sorry. Applause and crowds can't change that. I want to ask how many people here actually go out and vote? Democracy is meant to be the voice of people who will go and vote for these politicians. They have to come out of space.
You see, our democracy has become too representative in character. We go out and we vote someone once in 5 years, and then we hand over destiny to that particular person for the next 5 years, and have absolutely no say in democracy. I think this is not democracy. We need to develop systems in our democracy where people get to speak, and they have a direct voice in our democracy.
So, Arvind, we do have local elections, panchayat elections. No, you have many elections, not just Lok Sabha.
No, you have many elections, but each of these elections, you just vote one person to power for the next 5 years. You see, when we had this constitution, I'm sure that the fathers, our forefathers who framed this constitution, thought that if you elect some person, he is your representative. We are the masters. And this representative will come back again and again to us and ask us, what kind of a law do you want? Unfortunately, in our democracy, after getting elected, he does not come to us. He goes to his party high command and asks what kind of law should be passed in parliament. So our democracy is not by the people, of the people, for the people. Our democracy is by the party high command, for the party high command, of the party high command. It's party high command. I can see several very eminent and very senior congressmen sitting in the audience. How many of you would have the courage to say no to Mrs. Sonia Gandhi if a whip were issued in the parliament and you were asked to vote for or against the bill? How many? There are many senior BJP leaders also sitting in the audience. How many of you would have the courage to go against the party whip? I think the time has come. One of the biggest contributions of this movement is it has raised some very basic and fundamental questions in the manner in which Indian democracy is being run.
But Mr. Gandhi, Sonia, would have been like Baba Ramdev if the BJP hadn't helped.
Sonia,
I don't agree with
that. Sonia, I'm sorry, we've run out of time. Being a TV anchor, you'll understand that. You know, I'm just going to make a couple of things which, unfortunately, our session is too short for that discussion. Before we do that, Shekhar, very quickly, a couple of remarks.
Yeah, I just want to say that at the risk of not getting booed by the whole audience, that whereas I agree with him on his criticism of our current democratic process, my fear is that if we go on the way we are going, we are not changing this democratic process, we are undermining the democratic process. And that we must do.
Ma'am, it's a good idea about extending the session. Maybe we'll just do it for 10 minutes more because the next session will last for 1 hour. That's the beauty about being in real time rather than being on electronic time. But Arvind, since we have a bit of time now, I think, you know, this rhetoric about I completely agree with you that democracy is not just about elections, you know. And the problem with our country has been that we have reduced it to merely electoral democracy rather than all the other institutions and other practices that make up democracy. So no arguments with you on that. But two questions. One is that this political bashing is a very easy job. We've seen how easily you can raise cheers. I would cheer. You know, it's very easy to blame people. And of course, the people who have been standing for politics, many of them come with corrupt intention and corrupt backgrounds. But equally, it is politicians and that political system, and it's the people who go to vote, that have kept our society safe. You know, every 5 years, the poorest in our country keep us safe as a society because they go and vote with great wisdom. When we were discussing this about rhetoric, in the beginning of this campaign, there was this very easy dismissal of politics and politicians. And you all said, you know, we will not stand for politics and for elections because we don't want to enter that dirty drain, you know. I'm approximating now, but that was the intention.
Don't approximate. You see, here I want to correct. we, from our platform, never said that all the politicians are bad. There are good politicians, there are bad politicians. We never said all political parties are bad. There are good parties, and there could be something wrong with some parties. There is.
And we know which they are.
But the public anger against the political process is so huge that when some of the politicians came to Jantar Mantar or came to Ramlila Maidan, the public booed them out. Annaji announced from his stage that we have to be, sabko izzat deni chahiye, sabko respect deni chahiye, kisi ko aap bahar mat bhejiye. Wo aaye, stage pe na aaye, samne aake baith jaye, lekin hum kisi ko beizzat karke nahi bhejenge. Hamare kisi se dushmani nahi hai, kisi ke sath durbhavna nahi hai. We have no ill feeling against anyone. This is what he announced, and some politicians did come back after that. So the movement, this was not movement's position, but it was the public anger which actually exploded at that time, and people actually booed some of the politicians out. And we have no this thing to say that we apologize to all those people who were booed out at that time.
Arvind, the statement many have said that Anna is Arvind and Arvind is Anna. That Arvind Kejriwal is very often controlling what's going on. The core committee is actually being run by Arvind Kejriwal, Kiran Bedi and Prashant Bhushan, and that really is the problem. Where's the democratic process within the Anna Hazare committee?
I can only encourage you to come to one of our core committee meetings and sit inside and see the discussions that take place. Please do come.
You must take us that invitation.
But do you feel there is the empire strikes back? The targeted focus on members of Team Anna, yourself, Kiran Bedi, Prashant Bhushan.
Right.
Is the team really in disarray? Is it much harder now to keep a positive momentum going rather than the negative back and forth that we are seeing every day? Where is the vision for India?
Aap hi log karte hain, NDTV dikhata hai,
Instagram dikhata hai. Now, when we supported it
inside. Two questions you've asked. One is, you see, systematically, each of the members of this committee, of this team, has been targeted. There was a fake CD against Prashant Bhushan, Shanti Bhushan. There were allegations against Justice Hegde. There were allegations against each. When they could not find allegations, anything substantial against some of us, they started saying, he's arrogant, he's rude, he's intolerant, he controls Anna. And breaking news, I could see tickers running, Arvind is arrogant, Arvind is rude, Arvind. If I am arrogant, I am willing to accept, please tell me where I have gone wrong, I will improve myself. I will change my conduct. And that is what is about. So if we have done something wrong, we would admit that we have done it wrong, we will change our course of action. The second question was, sorry, I forgot.
Team Anna being disarray, rather than a positive momentum, it's all a negative momentum fighting
allegations. Yeah, the empire striking back, you said. You see, we are being hounded out, we are being chased, our telephones are being tapped, our past lives are being dug. I can just give you a small incident day before yesterday. Yesterday, Annaji broke his Manvrat. Day before yesterday, I got a phone call from one of his assistants who was reading out a message, small message that he had for me. He told me that he wants to come to Delhi, he wants to go to Rajghat. And he wants to sit in peace at Rajghat for 15 minutes without any media, without any public. Wo bole ki meko shanti ke saath 15 minute Rajghat pe baithna hai. Arvind, can you arrange this for me and not tell it to anyone? Within 15 minutes of this conversation, we got a phone call from the police saying that Anna ji ka Rajghat ka kya program hai. Hamari har baat tap ho rahi hai. Now, under the law, your phone can be tapped only if you are a threat to national security. I want to ask the government of India, are we a threat to national security? Is Anna Hazare a threat to national security? Am I a threat to national security?
Arvind, you know, I think one of the questions that Shekhar... You know, Tehelka itself has been the... I'm just going to wrap this up. Last question.
Yes, has been a victim of all
have this. Been the victim of, you know, bringing a message and bringing an uncomfortable message is always dirty business, difficult business. And I'm totally with you about don't shoot the messenger, you know. But Shekhar, I'd like both of you actually to answer this, that would you accept that, again, I come back to this issue of rhetoric, that too much of the Lokpal bill is predicated on the idea of immaculate virtuousness, you know. You mounted it as a movement that was built on the idea of virtuousness of you. And as you know, you're a friend. Prashant Bhushan is a co-traveler. nobody is questioning your credibility, but this is not just about the class that will happen under your, you know, on your watch. It is about future generations. We are legislating for the country. Why are we assuming that we should create institutions to which only immaculate human beings will come, and we must give them this power so that they will wield it on our behalf? Rather than disaggregating power, we are still giving power to one good man. Why are we doing that?
We are not doing it. Shoma, you brought the debate.
33,000 good people, you know.
You brought the debate back to that. If you have time, I can answer that, but I would need time to do that. You see, enforcement agency has to be given powers. You cannot have an enforcement agency and not give them the basic tools to investigate and prosecute. You have to give them powers, but you have to make them accountable. Please don't be taken, because if you start running this campaign that let's not give power to the Lokpal, Raja would be very happy about.
No,
because
I mean, I think
just one second, let me complete my argument. After that, you can say whatever.
Because I'm feeling as if you haven't understood what I'm saying, which is why I'm trying to reiterate.
No, all that I'm trying to say is that let's make this body accountable. Let's sit down, let's discuss what more we have tried to put. We got very good suggestions from NCPRI on 28th April. We put all of them. There should be a social audit, there should be independent complaints authority, various transparency measures. We've incorporated all of that. Let's sit down and see, if someone goes corrupt in this Lokpal, how do we ensure that we have proper systems in place? You see, no one is born corrupt and no one is born honest. It is the systems which make the people corrupt and honest. Today you have CVC, where there are 232 people and half of them are corrupt. But you have Delhi Metro, where there are 7,000 people, and Delhi Metro delivers you the best metro in the world. Why? Because they have best systems in place. So it's not about the size of the institution. Even you have 20,000 people, if you put the right kind of systems in place. So the time has come, Shoma, when we need to discuss the governance systems that we have in our country. Let's put the right kind of systems in place. The biggest problem is lack of accountability and lack of responsibility in our country. So let's put the right kind of accountable systems in place so that if someone does wrong, he goes to jail.
Okay. We have to wrap this up. We have to wrap this up. I think, you know, Shekhar had more things to say. The good part is we can discuss this outside still. The real triumph of this, even as we continue to disagree on many of the issues, the triumph of this, as we said earlier, was that corruption, governance has become the dominant conversations in India today. There are many things that still need to be sorted out. For instance, a lot of bureaucracy, government have been saying that there is a fear, there is paralysis. I think that's a short-term problem that has arisen. As things pan out over time, we will adjust ourselves to new processes. I think that paralysis will move away as people understand how to still pass files without having the media come at you and misinterpret you. The media has been a big player in this. We haven't had time to discuss it. I think it's been a positive and a very, very negative player in this entire game. And in fact, Arvind mentioned earlier in a private conversation that he feels they handled the media wrong. They were not really prepared for the kind of absolute spotlight that would come on them and how to calibrate their discussions on it. But a triumph is that we have a packed hall, and never has corruption been discussed with more passion. Thank you for listening.